بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Our topic today is about hypokalemia. Why should we care for potassium? Potassium is doing so many functions for the body which is vital, like transmission of nerve impulses, contraction of cardiac muscle, maintenance of intracellular tonicity of skeletal and smooth muscles, maintenance of normal renal function. And since potassium is mainly an intracellular cation, the drop in the serum potassium represents only a fraction of the actual loss. It is estimated that for each 1 milliequivalent per liter drop in the serum potassium, there is a loss of about 100 to 200 milliequivalent of total body potassium. Hypokalemia is divided into grades. It can be mild, with potassium levels between 3 to 3.5 millimol per liter, or moderate if it is below 3 millimol per liter, or severe when it is less, potassium is less than 2.5 millimol per liter. And hypokalemia per se can increase in hospital mortality up to tenfold, and this marked increase of mortality is due to its arrhythmogenic effect of the hypokalemia. Now, we have a general idea in medicine that human beings are not static like buildings, like cars, like machines. They are always in a state of movement, in a state of balance, which is guarded closely to keep what we call the homeostasis. This balance can be seen in the cells of the body. We have here representation of the intracellular fluid with potassium shifting inside the cells under effect of insulin or beta agonist, or potassium shifting out due to hyperosmolarity, exercise, or cell lysis. Actually, this change or redistribution can be manifest as hypo or hyperkalemia. Now, what about causes of hypokalemia? We have spurious or false hypokalemia. Then, general categories: renal losses, GIT losses, effect of medication, or redistributional or transcellular shift of potassium. The renal losses has different causes, especially renal tubular acidosis, effect of hyperaldosteronism. Remember, aldosterone normally inducing sodium retention and potassium excretion. The effect of magnesium depletion, as we'll talk about later on, also in leukemia. GIT losses with vomiting, diarrhea, use of enemas or laxatives. The effect of medication is very important since it is very common. Use of diuretics, which is almost the most common cause for hypokalemia we've seen in practice. Beta adrenergic agonist used by patient with bronchial asthma, the steroids, theophylline, aminoglycosides, and then the transcellular shift or redistribution, which can induce hypokalemia. What about the false or spurious hypokalemia? Very common cause is delayed sample analysis. You send your sample of your patient to the lab for analysis of the serum potassium, then it is not processed immediately. It is left for some time. And during the time, there is an increased cellular uptake, which can be manifest, especially if the temperature is increased. Patient with profound leukocytosis and cases of acute leukemia can induce artifactual hypokalemia, and it is also time dependent upon the uptake of potassium by the large white cell mass. In these two conditions, we should note that immediate processing of the sample is important to avoid false hypokalemia. And it is to be noted that this patient with false hypokalemia due to lab error or delayed processing of the sample does not suffer the clinical consequences of hypokalemia, and it doesn't need treatment. It does need immediate processing of another sample to get the true value of the potassium in the blood. Again, this is the representation of how potassium is lost from the body, either by decreasing intake over a long time, by vomiting, effect of hypothyroidism, effect of Cushing syndrome, or primary aldosteronism. Remember that steroids in general and aldosterone in particular induce sodium retention with potassium excretion. In cases of malabsorption syndrome, in which the potassium intake by the with the food is not reabsorbed. Very important is the effect of diuretics, as we said before, and cases of renal tubular acidosis in which potassium is lost with the urine. We need to know more about redistribution of hypokalemia. The movement of potassium from the serum or the blood to the inside of the cells showing potassium is low. Factors which is common include administration of insulin, and some claim that this effect can be a cause of what is called dead in bed syndrome, in which somebody trying to have tight control of blood sugar, the induced hypokalemia associated of the lowering of the blood sugar with the use of insulin, inducing arrhythmia during sleep, which can be a cause of this. Also, with all over sympathetic stimulation, hypokalemia can be induced in such a condition with sympathetic activity increased, as in acute myocardial infarction, in cases of head injury. And it is observed that in the redistributive hypokalemia after severe head injury, potassium can be lowered down to 1.2 or 1.9 millimole per liter. But the problem here is that we shouldn't be vigorous about giving much potassium to replace this, since after some time there is rebound efflux of potassium from the cells to the serum, which can precipitate hyperkalemia instead. And also the use of beta agonist like salmeterol or salbutamol or albuterol, or can induce redistribution of potassium inside the cells with hypokalemia. The group of drugs inducing redistribution and hypokalemia include pseudoephrine and ephedrine used in cough syrups, which is very common, and also xanthines, such as theophylline, used for bronchial asthma, not much before, like before. Also, dietary caffeine may induce hypokalemia, and the cases of chloroquine toxicity can be associated with hypokalemia. Now, how the hypokalemia affects the body? Hypokalemia causes myocytes to become hyperexcitable, lowering the membrane potential in the atrium and causing arrhythmia. Since the triggering of an action potential is more likely in such a condition, and it inhibits the inward potassium current and delaying ventricular repolarization, which can promote reentrant arrhythmia. Symptoms and signs of hypokalemia differ according to its severity. In mild hypokalemia, patient can be without symptoms or can have some small elevation of blood pressure, and some cardiac arrhythmias can happen, like premature beats, for example. In moderate hypokalemia, with serum potassium between 2.5 to 3 milliequivalent per liter, muscle weakness is there. There is myalgia, there is muscle cramps, and constipation from disturbed function of the muscles of the intestine. In severe hypokalemia, there is flaccid paralysis, and there is hyporeflexia. And there are reports of rhabdomyolysis occurring with profound hypokalemia, and serum potassium less than 2 milliequivalent. Respiratory depression from severe impairment of skeletal muscle function can be found. The most dangerous, of course, is having arrhythmia, which can be fatal. What about the renal effect of hypokalemia? There are two types. There can be structural changes in the glomeruli and tubules, and there can be functional disruption resulting in decreased glomerular filtration rate and increased proximal tubular immunogenesis. That's why patient can develop alkalosis due to hypokalemia. Also, hypokalemia will decrease the sensitivity of the aquaporin 2 channels in the distal tubule, decreasing its response to the vasopressin or antidiuretic hormone, resulting in nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Also, aldosteronism is another effect of hypokalemia. We know that aldosterone, as we said before, stimulates sodium reabsorption and potassium excretion. It is natural that low potassium in the blood will suppress the production of aldosterone to minimize or reduce the potassium excretion in such a condition, a sort of protective mechanism. Now, how to diagnose? Gold standard is having serum potassium level. Such a condition, it is less than 3.5 milliequivalent or 3.5 millimole per liter. We have to check the blood urea nitrogen and the creatinine level. We have to check glucose, and especially we have to check magnesium. As we will tell later on, magnesium is very important and can antagonize our trials to conduct hypokalemia. We'll check the calcium and phosphorus level also, since any associated electrolyte imbalance, especially hypomagnesemia, should be corrected. If the patient is on digoxin, we should check the level of digoxin in the blood, since digoxin toxicity is exaggerated or more manifest in presence of hypokalemia. And also we have to check blood gases, as alkalosis can induce hypokalemia, and hypokalemia can induce alkalosis. Its presence, I mean alkalosis, should be corrected as well depending on its cause, if not due to the hypokalemia itself. For example, somebody coming as repeated vomiting, he will be having hypovolemia, which will induce aldosterone secretion, secondary hyperaldosteronism, which will induce sodium retention with bicarbonate with potassium excretion. In such condition, you will have alkalosis and you will have hypokalemia. You have to correct the alkalosis to get potassium corrected at the same time. Now about the ECG. The manifestation of hypokalemia mainly affect the T wave, which will become flattened or inverted. And we got a sort of new wave, prominent T wave, following the T wave. In severe cases, the T wave almost be absent and replaced by the U wave. It will mimic a prolonged QT interval. The STC segment is depressed. And of course, ventricular arrhythmia can happen, like BVCs, premature ventricular contraction, torsion de Bois, or ventricular fibrillation, of course, which can be fatal. This is a closer lookup at the ECG changes. We will notice here the ST depression, and we will notice that the T wave is biphasic due to the presence of the U wave itself. You have T wave, which is smaller than usual, and followed by the U wave. And actually, this ECG is very nice, showing the changes in the ECG in mild, in moderate, and in severe hypokalemia. In A, in the figure is showing the normal ECG with normal serum potassium. In B, the potassium is only seriously equivalent. And we notice that there is ST depression and there is U wave separate and joining the T wave. In figure C, the serum potassium is only 2 milli equivalent with more marked ST depression and with the T wave almost absent. Just there is a notch showing, or some little prominence showing, representing the T wave, while the U wave is prominent more. And the figure T, D, with potassium only 1 milli equivalent, much more changes. The T wave almost absent, and the U wave is hyperacute, is increasing in size. Remember, this is important to know, since when we see ST depression in ECG, we naturally think of patient having ischemic heart disease. But remember, not all ST depression is due to ischemia. It can be due to electrolyte imbalance. And the safeguard here, when you have such changes, always check on the electrolytes, especially potassium and magnesium, to make sure these changes is not due to electrolyte imbalance, namely hypokalemia, not ischemic heart disease. Diagnostic approach to hypokalemia. Essentially, try to differentiate the cause of the hypokalemia. Is it renal or extrarenal? This will depend on the concentration of potassium in the urine. If the potassium in the urine is less than 30 milli equivalent per liter, this means that the loss is extrarenal, as in cases of resistant vomiting or diarrhea. And in such a condition, the kidney is conserving the potassium. That is why the concentration will be relatively low. However, if the potassium concentration in the urine is more than 30 milli equivalent per liter, the cause can be renal, or still it can be extrarenal. How to differentiate depends on the urinary chloride concentration. If it is more than 15 milli equivalent per liter, the cause is a diuretic or magnesium depletion. And remember that diuretics like furosemide acts by increasing chloride secretion. That's why it would be high in the urine. If the chloride is less than 15 milli equivalent per liter, the cause can be other things like nasogastric drainage or cases of alkalosis. We'll mention briefly some syndromes associated with hypokalemia as well. The first is the Potter syndrome, which is a combination of hypokalemia, alkalosis with normal or low blood pressure, and the elevated plasma renin and aldosterone. It is an inherited defect in the thick ascending lamp of the lobe of Hennel, and it can present either in neonatal life or in the adult life. The last is called the classical Potter syndrome. Another condition which may present and mimic or the hypokalemia is the familial hypokalemic periodic paralysis, in which there is a defect of a muscular ion channel due to hereditary causes, and there is a combination of severe hypokalemia and muscle weakness, usually precipitated by catecholamines released under stress or exertion, insulin after heavy carbohydrate meals, and associated also with excess thyroid hormones in cases of hyperthyroidism. This thyrotoxic hypokalemic periodic paralysis is specific to some ethnic groups like Japanese and Chinese, in which there is a thyrotoxicosis with hypokalemia and periodic paralysis manifested by weakness of all four limbs. The other syndrome we'll mention is the Liddle syndrome, which is again a rare hereditary disorder involving increased activity of the epithelial sodium channels, which causes the kidney to excrete potassium but retain too much sodium and water, leading to hypertension in association with fluid retention and metabolic alkalosis. It's characterized by severe hypertension, low plasma renin, hypoaldosteronism, and metabolic alkalosis, and the hypokalemia, of course. How to treat Liddle syndrome? Usually are using potassium-sparing diuretics like amiloride or triamcinolone. Here, use of spironolactone is not effective because, as we have mentioned, actually the mineralocorticoid effect, the aldosterone effect, is much less. It is suppressed by the sodium and water retention. So since the aldosterone is already low, spironolactone will not be effective. The first two is the one used, amiloride or triamcinolone. Another syndrome is Gittleman syndrome. Gittleman syndrome, this is an autosomal recessive disorder, and there is effect simulating the effect in the thiazide diuretics. It looks as if the patient is using thiazide diuretics while he is not using anything, since there is a sort of hyperactivity of the receptors of the kidney, which usually is affected by the thiazide diuretics. This is called the sodium chloride cotransporters. The manifestation will be hypokaloremic metabolic alkalosis, hypokalemia, and hypocalciuria. Hypomagnesemia can present in some of the patient. How to treat Gittleman syndrome? We have to replete the potassium loss either orally or with IV replacement, especially if the hypokalemia is severe and presenting with cardiac manifestation, as we have explained in ECG. We have, of course, to make precaution that potassium is not given in dextrose at all. We never give potassium with dextrose to treat hypokalemia. As we know, dextrose will stimulate insulin secretion, which will promote potassium moving inside the cells, lowering the serum potassium more. Usually are using it with saline in whatever concentration as a normal hypotonic saline, but no, don't use D5 at all. We expect that each 10 milli equivalent of potassium given will increase the serum potassium by 0.1 millimol per liter, meaning you have to give about 1 millimol of potassium chloride to raise the serum potassium by 1 millimol per liter. We have explained this before, that the potassium is mainly intracellular, and the potassium we are giving is diffusing inside the cells, and the total loss is much more than we see in the serum potassium. This has been discussed at the start of this lecture. At the same time, if there is magnesium deficiency, if there is hypomagnesemia, we have to correct, as we have said also before. Now, we will talk a little about the mechanism of the potassium movement inside the renal cells. We have here a figure showing the renal tubular cells. As we see, under the effect of aldosterone, the sodium is moving from the tubular fluid to the epithelial tubules of the renal tubules and out to the blood on the right side. In exchange for the potassium, potassium moving from inside the cells, from the tubular cells to the tubular fluid to be excreted with the urine. This is what we call the sodium potassium excretion, and it is under the effect of aldosterone hormone, inducing what we usually take as for granted, that aldosterone results in sodium retention and the potassium excretion. And consequently, when there is hyperaldosteronism, one manifestation will see that sodium is retained more, inducing hypernatremia and hypertension, and the potassium is lost, resulting in hypokalemia. While the opposite also is true, cases of hypoaldosteronism is associated with sodium loss in the urine, resulting in hyponatremia, and potassium retention resulting in hyperkalemia. This usually occurring in the distal tubular cells. Actually, this is more detailed explanation of the mechanism of the potassium shift from the extracellular to intracellular cells. We don't have to remember everything about it. Most important to remember the end result. We said before about the extracellular and intracellular shift of potassium and the factors affecting it. Now, this explains why hypomagnesemia result in hypokalemia and why we should correct the magnesium so that potassium can be corrected. Actually, magnesium regulates the activity of the rhomic. What is the rhomic? Rhomic is an abbreviation for the renal outer medullary potassium channel. And this potassium channel, when there is high intracellular magnesium, it will block this rhomic channel pores and prevent potassium from effluxing or passing out to the tubular, from tubular cells to the tubular fluid and be lost in the urine. So in cases of hypomagnesemia, these pores of this rhomic channel will be opened and the potassium will be lost. That's why cases of hypomagnesemia in association with hypokalemia, we'll find it very difficult, if not impossible, to correct the potassium until we can correct the magnesium back to normal. Since in presence of hypomagnesemia, whatever potassium we are giving to the patient, it is lost in the urine. It is very important to notice and to correct. Now, what about alkalosis? Alkalosis will induce hypokalemia by different mechanisms. One of them is the loss through the urine. One of them is the it will stimulate shift of the potassium from the extracellular fluid to the intracellular fluid. To correct hypomagnesemia, we add 48 millimol of magnesium sulfate, that is 3 ampoules of 20% magnesium sulfate, to 1 liter of normal saline and run it IV at 40 ml per hour. We monitor serum magnesium every 12 hours, and when serum magnesium is within normal range, we have to continue treatment for 48 hours more to replenish body stores of magnesium. Treatment of hypokalemia will include first, as usual, assessment of the situation of the patient. If severe hypokalemia is suspected, patient should be placed on a cardiac monitor and have an intravenous access established and assessment of his respiratory status. The potassium therapy will depend on the symptomatology of the patient and the severity of the condition, and the treatment should be started after lab and confirmation of the diagnosis. Cases with mild or moderate hypokalemia with potassium level between 2.5 to 3.5 milliequivalent per liter, which is usually asymptomatic, can be treated orally if the patient can retain the potassium chloride given, meaning if there is no persistent vomiting or diarrhea. Even with this level, if there is cardiac manifestation as seen in the ECG changes, patient should be started in IV therapy. Cases with initial potassium level less than 2.5 milliequivalent per liter should be started on intravenous potassium, and the admission in such a condition is indicated, and it should be in intensive care unit where there is facility of cardiac monitoring and infusion pumps to make sure about the infusion of potassium to be properly given. Same time, we should check for level of magnesium. If it is low, it should be corrected. Now about potassium therapy. If it is given IV, we can give it either through peripheral vein when the infusion rate shouldn't exceed 10 milliequivalent per hour, and the maximum dosage is not more than 200 milliequivalent per 24 hour. Patients should be on cardiac monitoring, especially if he has a compromised cardiac function or there is an acid change associated with the hypokalemia. Always potassium chloride should be diluted with saline solutions. Never use the 5% as it can aggravate the hypokalemia by stimulating the insulin secretion and moving the potassium from the extracellular fluid to the intracellular fluid. When higher concentration of potassium is needed, we should use a central line, and we can give about 10 to 20 ml equivalent of potassium, mixed in 100 ml of fluid and infused over 1 hour. And the higher rate can be given through a central vein under cardiac monitoring. Monitoring should include repeated estimation of the serum potassium, say every 4 or 6 hours. Follow up the urine output, make sure it is adequate. Look for any vein at the injection site if we are using a peripheral vein. Cardiac monitoring for any changes in the ECG of the patient. Of course, infusion pump must be used to make sure that the rate should be constant and in the range, which shouldn't be, as we said, more than 10 ml equivalent per hour. That will be all for hypokalemia. Thank you for your attention. Hope we